In this video, we're going to revisit a topic that we've covered once before, which is relative compression testing using an amp clamp and a PicoScope. We're going to redo this, we're going to add some things. So this time, not only are we going to use the amp clamp, we're going to go a little bit deeper with the setup on the software side, and then also how to use the voltage probe to look at voltage changes to give us really the same information and use some math channels to flip that and maybe make it a little bit easier to read. So quick background, why should we do this test? Relative compression testing gives us an idea about whether or not the engine mechanically has the ability to create equal compression. It's not going to tell us the exact compression, but it's going to help us understand whether I've got a loss of compression issue. And this is really important in diagnostics, that early on we figure out, do I have a mechanical fault or an electrical fault, so that I can pick a path more quickly and get down that path to find the issue. So we're going to be using the PicoScope 4425A for this, and so that includes their amp clamp that's self-powered, a little bit different. You could do this with any oscilloscope as long as you have a current clamp and a set of voltage leads. It just needs to have a fairly good sample rate. The reason why we won't use the DVOM is because this meter averages the reading that it sees, and so it's not going to give us the real-time information that we need, and we'll see how that looks once we get the voltage waveform captured. So I'm going to start out with my 12 volt leads. I've just got some of the alligator, you know, clip style adapters so I can put this on the battery. So next I'm going to hook up my current clamp or my amp clamp. I'm going to look at the arrow for direction of flow here, and I can pick a side, whether I use the positive or negative side. Either one's going to give me the information I need. I just want to make sure I point the arrow in the direction of electron flow. So this one looks like it's pretty easy to get around all the positive wires, so I'm going to go around that. All right, so we've got everything hooked up here. Let's talk about the setup. So I've got on my channel A, the voltage probes that are just connected to my 12 volt battery in the car. Lead B, or channel B, is hooked up to my current clamp. We've got that around the positive cables coming out of the battery. And then channel C, we've added, this is going to an ignition coil. So that lead is here, it's just into the trigger wire for the ignition coil. I've identified that without a wiring diagram. In this case, oftentimes with the ignition coils or even fuel injectors, I could look at all four of these and look for what's unique, right? And so four of the wires all have similar jobs, but one of those wires is unique to each cylinder for sequential firing of the ignition coil. So here I've got a pink and this one is red. So I've gone with that red wire on the ignition coil. So now on our screen, we've got a capture already up here so we can talk through some of the setup and how we got to this point, right? And so initially we got to pay attention to all the channels I plugged in, and depending on the scope that I've got, I may need to tell it the lead type. This 4525A PicoScope is going to auto identify my leads. If I didn't have that, I'm gonna have to pick those, right? So on channel A is my times one or just standard probe. We're gonna scale that to 20 volts so that I can capture my 12 volt events but have some room, right? I can always zoom in later, but if it goes out of range, I lose that information. So I always want to collect as much as I can. Channel B, 2000 amp current clamp, set up for 1000 amps of resolution. I know I'm gonna get a spike that's 600 or so as we see on the screen, right? So I've chosen 1000. Channel C is also going to be 12 volts, and so we've selected 20 to make sure that we get that full picture. The last thing that we had to do is come up here and look at the time scale. The default for PicoScope is often 5 milliseconds per division, which is too close for a test like this. And so I've got it back out at 200 milliseconds per division so that we can see that whole event walk across the screen. So then there's one additional thing that we've got on the screen here. We've got three leads, but you see four traces. And so this dark kind of navy trace, this is a math channel, right? So this is up here under tools, math channels, and invert channel A. The idea behind this is that initially when we look at this, we'll take it away. Here I've got in blue my voltage, in red I've got my current, and then in green is my trigger event for ignition coil on cylinder number one. When I look at these should always be the inverse of each other. You see them cross and then become pretty mirrored images, that as the starter motor turns the engine, and there's a compression event, the starter has to work harder. It takes greater current, which registers on my red trace. So every time I see a current peak, that's a compression event within a cylinder. And the opposite happens with my voltage. Anytime the battery needs to deliver more current, we're gonna see a dip in the voltage at the battery. And so we see those be inverse. And one of the things that math channel can do is just to flip the voltage so that you're really looking at two things that are the same. And not a necessary step, but just a fun one that kind of gives you two lines that are going to mirror each other. You can even stack them on top of each other, and they are very, very close. So that's an example of what good looks like, and it's always great to have that. As you get into using scopes more and more, that's the biggest challenge is, what does a bad trace look like? Well, you gotta know what good looks like in order to get there. So now that we know what good looks like, we're gonna take a spark plug out of a cylinder, repeat the test so that we can see what would this look like if I had a low compression event on a cylinder. So there right away, we could hear the rhythm of the engine. We know there's a dead hole. Let's take a look at the waveform. So I'm gonna take my tool, zoom in on just one full event here. We'll run the vertical up just a little bit. So here we can see another tip, another thing we could do is go to channel B. I'm gonna scale my B channel up by a factor of 2, and I'll do the same thing with A. That's just gonna give me a more pronounced peak, so it's a little bit easier to look at. So we used our ignition coil on cylinder 1 as a trigger. And so each of those square waveforms on the green channel represent cylinder number 1 happening. So in order to understand this, we need the firing order. So if we go over to service information, my firing order for this vehicle is 1, 3, 4, 2. So if we take that back and apply that, here at this first trigger where I see my waveform is cylinder 1, this should be 3, 4, 2, and I go back to 1 again. So we'll see a huge void here with a lack of current where cylinder 3 should be, right? And cylinder 3 is the cylinder where we removed the spark plug. So that's our relative compression test using the PicoScope, right? We used the current clamp, we added voltage this time, and looked at how could we sync that to understand rotation of the engine, right, and where it's at in those events. This test, again, is really great to help quickly get into one of the two diagnostic tracks and know when I've got a misfire, is this a mechanical issue or is this an electrical issue? Very important. It's a quick setup, gets me into that diagnostic path more quickly, and should save me some time in the long run.